best never comes easy. That's why there's nothing else like it.
I never believed in things that I couldn't see. I said if I can't feel it, then how could it be? No magic could happen to me. And then I saw you, I couldn't believe it. You took my heart, I couldn't retrieve it. Said to myself, what's it all about? Now I know there can be no doubt. You can do magic. You can have anything that you desire. Magic. And you know you're the one who can put out the fire.
Story of the 1982 Baltimore Orioles. Something magic happens. There is something about the start of any baseball year that always brings out a mixture of excitement and anticipation. Such was the case on April 5th, 1982, opening day at Baltimore. As the largest regular season crowd in Memorial Stadium history, more than 52,000 fans turned out to see the new look the Orioles had brought to town. And it was an auspicious moment as the man who claimed this season would be the last, manager Earl Weaver, took a bow. And with team owner Edward Bennett Williams looking on, Mayor William Donald Schaefer helped get the season cranked up as he handled the first ball honors. But even though the pregame festivities were over now, it was soon clear that the party was just starting. Rookie Cal Ripken came to bat in the second inning with a man on base, and from the coaching lines at third, Cal Sr. offered encouragement as Cal Jr. ripped one. Ripken's first major league home run signaled the start of something big as the Orioles went ahead of the Kansas City Royals 2-1. On this crisp April afternoon, the Orioles kept the heat turned on, and in the third inning, with the bases loaded, Eddie Murray exploded. Murray's fifth career grand slam blew the game wide open. Then a solo blast from Gary Renicky made the score 7-1, but the Birds weren't done yet. In the seventh, newcomer Dan Ford added a three-run shot that capped off a 13-run inaugural celebration, and it certainly looked like these springtime Orioles were on the wing. But the early Birds soon reverted to a very familiar form of early season woes. And the more the frustrations grew, the more the men in blue got a chance to hear from an old friend. Change is as much a part of baseball as it is anything else in life. From generation to generation, the game goes on, and no better proof of that was the success of Cal Ripken Jr. Becoming an everyday player at the age of 21, Cal made a remarkable adjustment to the pressures of the big leagues as he finished the year with 28 home runs and 93 RBIs. But to many, one of the most intriguing aspects of Ripken's first season was that he now played for a team his father coached.
It was a unique situation. I've never had my father around in any league I played at. But early in the season, it was a little strange. I didn't know how to take it at first. I got used to it. He got used to it. And right now, it's easy. We go out there, everybody accepts him as a coach, accepts me as a player, and that's as far as it goes.
Starting the year as a third baseman, Ripken was switched at the beginning of July to shortstop. And that successful transition, along with his clutch power hitting, helped bring Ripken the American League's Rookie of the Year award.
Little drive to left field. This game may be over here. Tip at the wall. Home run, Ripken, and the Baltimore Orioles win it.
As the season moved into summer, the Orioles got hot. In July, the Birds went on a 7-game win streak as the spell cast by pitching, defense, and the long ball worked its charms. And there was no doubt that Oriole's magic still had a potent force.
I heat up, I can't cool down. Got me spinning round and round. Round and round and round it goes. Where it stops, nobody knows. Every time you call my name, I heat up like a burning flame. Burning flame, full of desire. Kiss me, baby, let the fire get higher.
You could say abracadabra, the Orioles, under the design of master architect Hank Peters, had re-emerged as division contenders. But it wouldn't have been possible without the day-in and day-out contributions of the unsung heroes whose steady presence was a necessity. Men like Rick Dempsey, one of the game's best defensive catchers, had a good reason why the Orioles should always contend for the Eraser Rate Award in gunning down enemy base runners. And Rich Dower was impeccable with the glove, showing the kind of quality that helped make the 82 Orioles the team with the fewest errors in the major leagues. Right-handed Gary Renicky changed his batting stance in the spring and found that it paid off with 21 home runs and 74 RBIs, while the other half of the Lowe and Rowe show, John Lowenstein, was a tower of power, batting .320 with 24 homers, his best season ever. Support came from the bench, the deep depth, players like Floyd Sugar Bear Rafer, who delivered a sweet surprise in a July game against Oakland.
Here's a fly ball, well hit, a fairly deep left, back goes Henderson, back at the wall, gone! Home run, Rafer, this game is all over, and the Orioles win it in overtime.
Benny Ayala had a fine season, batting .375 as a pinch hitter, while also serving in a left field platoon system with Renicky and Lowenstein that produced an awesome 41 homers and 123 RBIs. And catcher Joe Nolan added extra muscle with a knack for late inning gamers.
In the right field, that one is going.
And of course, there was Terry Crowley, who recorded his 100th career pinch hit and helped the Birds set a league record with 11 pinch hit home runs in 82.
Back there, gone, a grand slam home run for Crowley, and the ball game is over.
From late August on, the Orioles were looking very good indeed as they kept moving on up to a familiar and winning beat.
So many things that's held us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go, and where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're putting ourselves together, we're polishing up our act. And if you've ever been held down before, I know you refuse to be held down anymore. Well,
don't you let nothing, nothing
An occasion of a different sort took place on Sunday, September 19th. It was a special day, a day of thanks to a man who had given so much of himself to Baltimore. It was a day in honor of a legend, the skipper, Earl Weaver. And it was also a celebration of all that Earl Weaver had achieved in his tenure of 15 years, a record that surely one day will lead him to the Hall of Fame. It was a day for memories as an entire city showed its appreciation and everyone present joined in as an original tribute was offered by baseball's poet laureate.
Well, I heard that Oriole fans could sing.
Simple and direct praise of the team's owner echoed the thoughts of all.
Let me try to say in three words what we've been hinting at for the last hour. We love you.
The ceremony soon reached their climax as the retirement of number four was announced and Earl Weaver became just the third Oriole to enjoy that distinction. Then Earl had a chance to say a thanks of his own.
Little did I know 15 years ago, when I came to Baltimore, how deeply I'd become attached to this city. The 15 years that I've spent here have been the happiest, without a doubt, in my life. Above all, my thanks has to be extended to all the players, present and past, and for their outstanding efforts and achievements that has allowed me to keep my job as manager of the Baltimore Orioles. These are the things that I'll never forget. And along with them, the memory of this day is going right with me to the grave. Thank you.
Subsequent to Earl Weaver's retirement at the end of the season, it was announced that the next manager would be an old friend, Joe Altobelli.
I couldn't be happier working or coming back to Baltimore, simply because I really don't feel that new here, because I've been here in the past. It was a ball club and organization that got me started, and it took a little while, maybe more than I thought it would take, but I finally got here. Now I'm hoping to be successful at every rung of the ladder in the Oriole organization.
Stage had been set for that unforgettable October weekend showdown. Four games with the first place Milwaukee Brewers. All four had to be won. Any loss would be fatal. Despite the odds, the Baltimore long shots were staying alive. Amassed seven runs on 13 hits in game two, the Brewers could only account for one. Meanwhile, the chant of sweep echoed through the sellout crowd. On the mound, Storm Davis was nearing his first complete major league victory. And in the ninth, Storm, just like a cyclone, blew past the Brewers and pennant pandemonium reigned again. Surviving the odds and staying alive, the Birds had swept the doubleheader. Now they trailed by just one game with two to go, and the next encounter was only hours away. On a golden October Saturday afternoon, the faithful flocked to the stadium early, confident that victory was once more at hand. In the first inning, the Birds wasted no time as they picked up where they had left off the night before. And the Brewers heard the footsteps of Orioles crossing the plate three times before the inning was over. But even though it seemed they had matters in hand, the Orioles were well aware that Milwaukee could lash out at any time. After all, the mighty Brewers did lead the majors in home runs. And sure enough, the Brewers did manage to tie the game at three. But then the Orioles took charge, thanks in part to Jim Dwyer, who was in the midst of an incredible string of reaching base 13 straight times. And nearly just as hot as Dwyer was Rich Dower, batting over 400 in his last 11 games. Dower added two more hits that day, each one helping to key four-run rallies as the Birds were flying high. While from the hill, Sammy Stewart, who had come on in the fourth, slammed the door on Milwaukee yet another time as he delivered a masterful performance. Baltimore had trounced the Brewers 11-3, and what had once seemed impossible now was truly within reach. One more day remained to decide the American League Eastern Division race, and the Orioles, who had won 22 of the last 26 games at home, knew that something magic had definitely happened.
Our fans are tremendous, and I think they pick us up a little bit. There's no doubt that you get that feeling that you want to do something for the people of Baltimore. It's been outstanding. They treat their professional athletes as well as they're treated in any city I've ever been in, going good, going bad, or whatever. And when they come out in the numbers they have and make the noise they have, I think it does something as far as adrenaline is concerned. We know they're with us and we want to do something for them.
Going into the final day, Baltimore and Milwaukee were tied for first, and the Orioles now called upon their ace, 15-4, Jim Palmer. But in the first, Palmer squared off against Robin Yount, who was having a brilliant season of his own. Yount's home run, putting the Brewers up 1-0, was his first of two on the day, and later, going into the bottom of the third, Milwaukee led 3-0. But the Orioles were still alive, as rookie Glenn Gulliver proved when he faced Don Sutton. Gulliver's first major league home run pulled the Birds to within two, as it put the Memorial Stadium crowd into a frenzy. And with the excitement building, the next batter, Ken Singleton, let loose. But Gorman Thomas made the play, and other frustrations would follow. In the bottom of the fifth, Baltimore had the bases loaded with two outs, and at the plate was the man selected as the year's most valuable Oriole, Eddie Murray. Cecil Cooper was there, and again, the Brewers had escaped. Then with Baltimore trailing 5-2 in the bottom of the eighth, there were two Orioles on base as pinch hitter Joe Nolan dug in. Dashing to the line was Ben Ogilvie, and the Brewer left fielder later said he couldn't believe this catch himself. So many chances had come so close, but it all came to an end in the ninth, following a Milwaukee rally, and this, the final out. After losing to the Orioles five straight times, the Milwaukee Brewers were Eastern Division champs. But no one would begrudge them their title, just as no one would begrudge Baltimore its sadness. Yet the magic was still not over, as described by Howard Cosell.
You are bearing witness to one of the most remarkable scenes maybe that you will ever see in sport. Yes, the fans have stayed. They have stayed to cheer. The defeat will hurt. There's Harvey Dean over to congratulate him. And Earl Weaver is crying. And you can understand it. Very rarely has there been a scene like this, if ever. These people of this city, a city that has become a beautiful city under a brilliant mayor with an inner harbor equivalent of Boston, and that's Edward Bennett Williams, the owner, the great criminal attorney. And there they are standing and chanting, all of them in unison. And the sign says it all. Goodbye, Earl, and you deserve it. You've been one of the greatest managers in the history of the game.
Farewell, Earl. In victory, there was so much greatness. And in losing this day, there was no defeat. The Baltimore Orioles tradition is a winning tradition, and the special quality of Orioles baseball will continue for years to come.
Something magic happens every time you go. You make the magic happen. The magic of Orioles baseball when the game is close. And the O's are hot.
1982 Orioles Highlights has been brought to you by Budweiser. For all you do, this Bud's for you.
Who's gonna hear the call? Every game has a different start. That's the magic of Orioles baseball. Happened.